Ham Radio Now, episode 158. We're going to say no on 4969. So you might have remembered from the last episode, we've been talking about the amateur radio parity bill. And let me see if I can take a quick look at that. This is the bill, H.R. 4969, Amateur Radio Parity Bill. The whole idea of that bill is to extend PRB1 coverage, which, as it stands right now, only covers governments, state and local municipal governments on antenna, mitigating antenna restrictions to some extent, onto private contracts from homeowners associations, you know, codes, covenants, and restrictions, things like that. So put that up, and a viewer sent me email. He's Mike Alexander, and here is Mike, N8MSA. Did you get your call sign right, Mike?
That's correct.
Okay. And you said that that you have a contrary view to promote to extending PRB1 into private contracts, and you wondered if I'd be interested, and yes, I'm very interested. Tell you what is the contrary view? What has given you heartburn about this?
Well, the heartburn that I'm getting about this, Gary, is something that you already touched on, that a CC&R, even though it may be onerous in many cases, is indeed a private contract, and I'm philosophically opposed to asking the government to come in to abrogate a private contract. That's my fundamental position about this.
So that's pretty simple. It's cut and dried. You don't want to see the government going into private contracts. And I take it this is sort of a general philosophy that you have about the way government ought to work?
Indeed. You know, I won't deny that, you know, I kind of lean towards the libertarian. But I think that this is in this particular case, it's not only a case of asking the government to come in, it's asking, you know, the camel to open the flap of the tent and stick its nose in. It's also unnecessary in most cases.
Now, that's an interesting point of view. Because my personal observation in shopping for houses and things like that is that it would have helped a lot. If you watched the last episode, you saw that I was able, in this circumstance, a brand new neighborhood where the builder was still the homeowners association at the time, I was able to negotiate. But without doing an extensive survey, I would say most hams moving into neighborhoods that have existing homeowners associations, existing CC&Rs, there's no negotiating. If you want to buy the house, you go with what the contract already says.
And I understand that position, and I do know that there are people that live in homeowners associations that are incredibly specific in their requirements. They're very detailed. They touch on anything cosmetic, having to do with the property, having to do with the house. Some actually will specify that people can't even wash their cars in their own driveways. So I understand that this is a difficulty for many people, but I also know a number of hams that have gone to their neighbors, and this really touches on the not completely necessary aspect. I think that there are remedies for this outside of court and outside of getting the federal government involved that have to do with the very nature of a CC&R. A CC&R is a legal and a social contract with your neighbors. Basically, you enter into an agreement to get your private street plowed or get your sidewalk plowed, perhaps, or basically all of you are agreeing that you're going to take care of your house to keep the appearance up, to maintain the property value. I mean, that really strikes the core of CC&Rs. This really strikes at the core of homeowners associations. And I did a little bit of research on this before I basically said, no, I don't like this. You know, I actually looked into this a little bit.
What did you find?
Well, and what I basically found is that, I mean, these were created towards the end of the 40s when there was a push, if you will, in local, state, and federal government to promote homeownership to help grow the economy and also to cope with the post-World War II baby boom. Many homeowners associations were created initially, and there's a lot of research that backs this up, initially to maintain a particular socio-demographic flavor of a neighborhood. In other words, keep people that were felt to be undesirable out of a neighborhood. But later, unfortunately, and again, there's a large body of research that supports that. Now, these...
Yeah, now, are we working on code words here, or are we talking about, you know, redlining and things like that, or
redlining? We're talking. Yeah. We're talking about redlining. We're talking about contractual redlining. Exactly. Yeah.
So we're talking about keeping black people, foreign immigrants, any, you know, pick the group that doesn't look like you and keep them out of your neighborhood.
Exactly.
So you don't think that's a good thing?
No, I don't think that's a good thing. But what happened over a period of time is that the FHA and other federal agencies, state agencies became involved and began to apply not a great deal, but some small amount of rulemaking directly to HOAs in particular, and also began pursuing HOAs that encouraged this kind of activity. So these really started turning into not methods of keeping people you didn't want out of the neighborhood, but maintaining your property value at the end of the day and getting stuff done.
Yeah.
So, you know, so they turned into relatively positive influences.
The property value thing is an argument that I hear a lot, but it's the easy thing to point to. It's a more difficult thing to prove. For example, the realtors that the hams employ will say, well, the neighbors will say your antenna brings my property values down. And the realtors and the experts on the ham radio side will say the research says, no, it doesn't.
Right. And I think that what you're dealing with here in many cases is just simply the gut instinct of the people involved. I would be very hard pressed to agree with somebody that would make the assertion that 1-inch tall grass is somehow more economically desirable than 2-inch tall grass. I personally find that silly. Yeah. I think the other extreme is that if your neighbor is scrapping refrigerators in their driveway and has dead cars in the front yard, it's probably going to bring the property values down.
Yeah.
So is a well-styled, difficult to pick out as a ham antenna going to have a significant negative impact? I don't believe that to be the case. Yep. However, I'm not the majority of people that are on a homeowners association. I don't live in the HOA neighborhood by design. And so I tend to look at things maybe a little more objectively. And Gary, I find that to be hard to support, but it's exactly what I hear when I talk to hams and other people. I mean, most of my friends and acquaintances are not hams. And the whole reason that they moved into HOA neighborhoods is basically an understanding, both a handshake agreement and a written agreement, that everybody's going to work together to, again, you know, I put it, get stuff done, but mostly to keep the property values up.
Do you think that that people deliberately move into HOA neighborhoods, or there's just one there and that's where they want to live, and so they have to go along with the HOA? Because it's not a negotiation. Your options are move into the neighborhood and sign the contract, or don't. You don't really have much of a choice. That you don't have at least I'm not aware of the concept of a negotiation as you move into a neighborhood the way I did in this pretty unique circumstance, I think.
No, and I think that your question is very to the point, in that I think that you can shop for a situation that you like. I don't think that you can negotiate with HOAs. In my house shopping in 30 years, I've never been able to, prior to moving in, to have any kind of contact or negotiation with a homeowners association representative. I could only look at the bylaws. And that's a key point. You know, going to the first aspect of your question, I think that there are people that don't have amateur radio antennas or other extraordinary hobbies where they have like a very large snowmobile trailer or a motorhome or something of that nature that is going to raise the ire, rightly or wrongly, of their neighbors. And so they're relatively unconcerned about this. They find a neighborhood, they find a house they like, they like the schools, they like access to stores and theaters. And so in many cases, most of the people I know don't, if there is a homeowners association, they're fine with it. They typically don't look at the details. Most of the people I know don't even have somebody take a very close look at the purchase agreement or the loan for their house. This is something that I personally don't understand. But most people don't. You know, most people glance at a contract when they're buying a car or buying a house and sign it. It's the same thing with a homeowners association agreement.
Yeah, and their heartburn will come when suddenly they find that it prohibits something that they want to do.
In my
neighborhood, changing the shade of the color of your paint, even a small amount, requires approval by the architecture committee. Which, once you start pointing things like that out, people go, what did I get myself in for? So,
well, and we joke about that, but one thing I'd like to point out briefly is sometimes the ramifications are much more serious. In my research, I found out, and I couldn't believe it to the extent initially that I actually had to call friends that I knew that live in Texas, that the laws are such in Texas that if you get behind in your HOA dues, that the HOA can actually foreclose on your house.
Yeah.
Outside of the normal due process that a lender would. I found it utterly fascinating, and it turned out to be true. And that's a much more serious ramification than having Mrs. McGillicuddy get mad because I painted my mailbox orange.
Yep. Let me take a look at Google Street View, if you don't mind, and show your neighborhood.
No, go ahead, by all means.
This is what your neighborhood looks like. Now, it appears that the Google car never went down your street.
I thought that it might have. That's not quite my address. You might want to double check.
No, that's not your address. Okay. That's as close as Google gets. This is your street. This is Elm Street.
Okay.
And your house is down here about a block away.
It's about a block and a half off of that main drag where you have your icon right now, exactly.
So this is you know, it's a typical, I would say suburban, although you live in a small town a little bit outside of Detroit.
That's correct. Probably about 30 miles northwest of Detroit, a town called Howell.
Yeah. So it's, I mean, would you consider it a suburb or is it just a small town?
It's actually a small town. I live smack dab right in the middle of small town USA. I'm about a quarter of a mile from the police station and city hall.
Yeah. And you you say that you picked a neighborhood to live in because it didn't have an HOA. Do some of the neighborhoods in Howell have HOAs?
Absolutely. Some do, some don't. And when we were going through the purchasing process, I think we went through about a 2-month qualification period, and I've got to be honest, I discarded anything that had an HOA, and this was prior to deciding to erect several antennas, including a 70-foot crank-up tower.
Okay.
This is well before that.
Looking at the picture down the street, I don't see a tower anyplace. Well, maybe I do.
That's not mine.
Not
I
yours.
Think you'd be hard pressed from this angle. You'd be very hard pressed to see it.
Okay, but you do have a 70-foot tower, so that's not too bad.
Right, and if you go to my QRZ page, you can actually see my avatar, if you will, my picture from my QRZ homepage, is actually my Step IR DB18E covering my house like an umbrella.
Okay, so this picture that we're looking at over here. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's your tower. It looks like it's maybe cranked down right now.
Right, it's not fully extended. That's correct.
Yep, and you have a stepper.
That's correct.
Cool.
Less visible from this angle are a couple of verticals and dipole and a mag loop and yada yada yada.
Okay, I'm jealous. So it's more than a matter of principle. It's a principle that you believe in. You also see that there are degrees, and some of them are more ridiculous than others, and you know some are quite legitimate.
I wanted to relate just a couple of things going back to your question about, right, some homeowners associations being more flexible than others. And I just wanted to relate, for example, one anecdote to you. I purchased a used linear amplifier from a gentleman that lived in a suburb of Chicago. And he lived in a very affluent neighborhood, a very nice house. The houses were separated probably by about 300 feet or so. So they're not right on top of each other. The key point being that he lived in an HOA that had a specific proscription against antenna towers, be they television antenna towers or be they cell phone antenna towers or amateur antenna towers. And he actually went to his neighbors and talked to them, described what he was going to do, showed them pictures, actually made a Photoshop of what it was going to look like. He bought a 70-foot crank-up, lay-down tower. He bought a Step IR TV-18E, ironically. And he actually got the buy-in from his neighbors to put that up. So he's one of a number of hams that I know that worked with his neighbors after the fact, you know, got into the hobby after they bought a house in a neighborhood with an HOA, and was still able to work something out.
Did he, or did you learn how he was able to approach neighbors and get their cooperation? Because we hear some success stories like that. We hear also horror stories where things have just gone from bad to worse, and you have a neighborhood feud that just goes on forever.
Yeah, I think his basic, and I asked him that very question, should I have ever run into it, and he basically said that he was honest. He showed them pictures of how it looked. One of the keys for him was the ability to make it go away when his neighbors asked him to. So whether it was a 43-foot vertical, as so many people find in vogue right now, or a tower with a Yagi on top of it, they basically ask, and he was more than eager to go along with this, that there would be times, neighborhood events, or if somebody was going to show their house or something like that, that they could basically make the antenna go away.
I see the problem with show the house. That's sort of a bait and switch thing.
Perhaps, but that's between him and his neighbors. But basically, he pre-visualized it. He put something together to show him what it would look like. He explained the importance of the amateur hobby both to himself and to them, that this gave him the ability to practice communicating with people. So if there ever was an emergency or, in some time of need, that he would have the requisite skills. He just approached it as a gentleman, basically, and they were happy to go along with it.
Yeah. I mean, there are stories on the other side. One of the hams in my radio club put up a very unobtrusive dipole, but it violated the restrictions that were already in place. And unfortunately, perhaps for him, he didn't go look for permission first, as many hams don't. And got the order to take it down, just a simple dipole. I prepared something that is similar to what you're describing, a document with some Photoshop stuff in it, and the rah-rah-rah about how wonderful ham radio is and the emergencies and things like that. And that got me as far as some dipoles and some little mobile whips. And the house that I was in had a 17-foot tall fiberglass dual band vertical, diamond vertical. That mm-hmm. was not going to fly. That house was not very far away. So they went and took a look at this stuff, and they said that would not fly. And anything talking about a tower and a beam antenna, that was not going to fly. So, you know, my limitations were going to be some very unobtrusive dipoles and some mobile whips that would stick up out of the roof and you know, be very hard to see. Well, that's still better than what a lot of people are able to get.
And I understand that, Gary. And I think that it's a matter of cooperation. Whether you read everything in detail or not, and whether you even have a CC&R or even live in an HOA, I think it's important if you live in a neighborhood, if you don't live thousands of miles away from everybody else, if you don't live in the tundra in Siberia, you need to cooperate with your neighbors. You know, it's a given that if you live in a neighborhood, then you have to cooperate with your neighbors. So even though I don't live in an HOA, I consulted with my neighbors before I put up my very first antenna and showed them what, you know, I was thinking of doing. I basically got everybody's buy-in, and I didn't need to. I didn't just do it. And I think that's one of the most important lessons, is that if you're in a neighborhood, if you're closely spaced up against other people, then you all have to cooperate. You know, keep your dogs from barking. keep a muffler on your car. You know, keep your snowmobile inside of the garage in summer. And if you talk to your neighbors and your neighbors are okay with a step IR vertical, then terrific. And if they're not, well, this is kind of what you signed up for. And in fact, it's not kind of what you signed up for. It's precisely what you signed up for.
Well, again, my point there is you didn't have much of a choice. You may have lived there before you became a ham. You may have other factors. Again, schools, jobs, commute, spouse, things like that, that override your desire for ham radio. And but the thing that I haven't talked about yet that I'd like to bring up and get your feedback on this, get your reaction, is that when hams talk politically, first of all, I think this is going to be very popular out there, and you're not, so you'll get some email from
popular this. Yeah, no more popular than I've ever been in the past.
Yeah, so not too worried about that. But when hams talk politically, and they do some, it's one of those things that we're advised not to talk about. But over mm-hmm. the decade or so, to a couple of decades, my theory is Rush Limbaugh has loosened a lot of tongues. When you hear hams talk mm-hmm. politically, most of what you hear is something fairly conservative, somewhere between fairly conservative to very conservative. You hear very little left-wing and liberal talk from hams. I know that there are some. I just don't think they talk about it very much. I'm not sure why. There may be some good reasons. This and the idea of not having the government, especially the federal government, intrude in your business, in your private contracts, is mm-hmm. is a part of that philosophy. There's a dichotomy then. If hams have that basic political philosophy, and yet it's their ox that is now being gored, and they would like to have that stop, that's kind of an interesting conflict.
It's a very interesting conflict. I find it, and you know, let the email and the snail mail roll in, I find it to be very hypocritical. It's not all that uncommon today, and it's very unfortunate. And you hear a lot of rationalizations. I've already had conversations with this in my local club, and while there are a handful of people that agree with me, most people cite, for example, the over-the-air reception devices rule, about dish antennas and TV antennas and things like that.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that too. And if people are not familiar with it, the FCC has stepped in to override CC&Rs on putting up TV antennas, broadcast reception antennas with limitations, you know, satellite dishes. But they are saying that no one can stop you from doing that. How do you feel about that one?
You know, I'm a little queasy about that, to be perfectly honest, but really we're comparing apples and oranges. So if you take a look at the over-the-air law in detail, it basically says a dish up to a certain size, antennas as are necessary to receive local TV broadcast. And basically, if you look at the reason why this was enacted, it was enacted because TV antennas are, even in these days of cable, almost ubiquitous. There is a significant economic impact to the United States from the entire TV industry.
Yeah, I can't quite let you go get away with that. In Howell, Michigan, they may be ubiquitous. Around here, they had disappeared couple of decades ago. There are no television antennas. I see them when I travel out into rural North Carolina, into very old towns. Then you start seeing these TV antennas up on roofs again. But that, to me, that's an anachronism.
I understand. I still see many of them around here, even though many communities have at least one franchised service, or maybe competition. They have multiple services. It's still not uncommon to go into the Detroit metro area and go into 500,000 population suburbs and still see a significant number of antennas. Perhaps not as many as the FCC envisioned when they created the high-definition broadcasting rules, but they're still out there. I still see them. I see them all across the Midwest. You know, I travel a great deal throughout Michigan, Ohio, Indiana, Illinois, and I still see a great deal of them.
Yeah, and there's a sort of a nascent cord cutter movement going on. I don't think that there's enough of those that are making a visual impact across neighborhoods yet, but folks are saying, yes, I'm going to let go of cable, and an option is to put up an antenna. Most people in urban areas and close-in suburban areas can put up an indoor antenna. There's some good ones coming up on the market. But in some areas, you need an outdoor antenna to get all the signals that you might like to be able to get. So I'm hearing that you're being consistent to your principles, and I applaud you for that. Fortunately, my political leaning doesn't give me any heartburn about this at all. I think that a reasonable amount of government intrusion in my life is it can protect me. The sword can cut both ways, no question about it. But this sort of thing.
I don't disagree with that at all. I'm not the kind of person that's going to cut off my nose to spite my political face. And I'm probably more moderate than I might sound. I agree that the whole purpose of government is to bring people together, to weigh the social cost of activities and kind of leaven the social cost of certain things. That's why we have seatbelt regulations, for example. Yeah. So I'm not completely phobic about the government.
Yeah, and there's some concept of the tyranny of the majority. We can't have majority rule in everything.
Right. Yeah, but again, this brings me to the whole point of, if you're going to have the government, be it local, county, state, federal, United Nations, if you're going to bring them into your lives, it should be for something a little less, and this is going to get me lambasted, but a little less trivial than asking the feds to tear apart several tens of millions of private contracts just so I can stick up an antenna. I think
a tear apart may be a little exaggeration, but I mean they would put a thumbprint on it. Maybe not even a boot print. A thumbprint is going to go on it.
Well, and I thought about this, Gary, and I use that specifically because often when you see a particular law that is changed or amended or created to address one specific thing, then it's leveraged in ways that you don't necessarily anticipate. So, and I don't think that this is an outrageous exaggeration, but if you look at the CC&Rs for many HOAs, for example, you can't work on your car at home, even in the privacy of your own garage. Now, whether or not they can detect that and stop that is a different topic. Many CC&Rs say that you can't wash your car in your driveway, which to me is an absurdity. But, you know, if you sign up for it anyway, the whole point is that, let's say, for example, that the SEMA, the Special Equipment Manufacturers Association, of whom which, say, the car wax companies belong to, you know, along with the tire companies and the wheel companies and so on and so forth, try to get on the heels of something that we ask for with respect to CC&Rs, try to get something changed. So anybody that wants to wash their car can, you know, again, it almost sounds like a good idea, but again, we're picking away at a private contract to benefit a few people relative to the entire population, the people that entered into these contracts knowingly and in good faith.
Yeah, the armchair lawyers will talk about, well, we are federally licensed, and you know, the details start to devolve into a lot of nitpicking. I kind of got to believe that those kind of arguments have already been going on, and I don't, you know, haven't seen any of them, but I'd be real surprised if organizations like that haven't already tried and perhaps failed already.
And they may have, and this is why. And going to your point, I think that there's going to be a number of amateur radio operators, irrespective of their political leanings, that are going to think this is a good idea. There's going to be a handful, such as me, that are not, but this brings me to the point of compromise. I think that one potential compromise could be amending this proposal, amending this bill, such that it essentially grandfathers in existing agreements, so they're not modified, they're not bent, you know, if you will, but that prohibits this from happening in the future. I would be much more comfortable with that, for example. So,
but go ahead, Greg. Let's look at the language again. If we are going to look at it fairly carefully, the language of the bill doesn't say that we'd completely abrogate the CC&R. It says that the homeowners association can restrict the antennas to the minimum practicable level to accomplish their reasonable goals. Now, all that is very fuzzy language, and it becomes tell it to the judge, but at least you get the opportunity to tell it to the judge.
And what I would suggest is that exact same language with a date, say, January 1st, you know, 2016, so on and so forth, any new applications for antenna structures necessary to support the communications, you know, et cetera, you know, same language, but with a phase-in date and ones that leave the current ones alone. Because irrespective of how vague that language is, it's still the modification that we're talking about. It's the bending, the changing of these private contracts.
Yeah, and that may be a pretty good compromise. It may be something, and who knows where this is really going to go. I personally expect it to go no place. Even though the committee that is going to take it up is chaired by a ham, the only ham in Congress, I still kind of expect that this congressional session will expire without action on it. Certainly without a companion bill in the Senate, the having whatever might appear in the Senate be harmonized with whatever finally is voted on in the House, if it ever gets that far, and get to a signature. I can see this at the very best going on over the next several years before it gets final resolution, if it ever does.
I tend to agree, and I think you would agree with me, that maybe they have bigger fish to fry.
Well, I have a real problem whenever someone diverts the attention of an issue that is being brought up by saying there's more important things to go do. There's always more important things to go do, but this is the thing we're talking about now. And so I'll resist someone saying, I'm sorry, we're not going to pay any attention to that because, you know, we need to solve a war in Iraq or whatever.
Understood, but I think that's what they will say.
Oh, sure. Yeah, that's going to happen. The last point that I'll make about this, and I'll give you a chance to say that, and then there's some other stuff I want to talk to you about, is that one thing this doesn't do is it doesn't set up any new bureaucracy. It doesn't set up a government agency, an oversight committee, or anything. It costs nothing, at least in federal dollars. There may be some, you know, court costs that will be generated as things go to court, because that's where they go when these things happen. But it is not setting up a layer of government, which my guess is that a layer of government would just have you going through the roof.
No, I believe that it would. And I think that this would be implemented exactly the way that PRB.
PRB1, yeah.
PRB1. I wanted to make sure that I wasn't transferring out PBR1, perhaps the ribbon one. yeah, I think it would be implemented essentially the same way. It would be tested in court. There would be precedent that would be set, and there would be the occasional fights. I mean, for example, the show that you did several months ago about the gentleman fighting the township in Ohio. But I think this would be done exactly the same way, so there wouldn't be the redundancy department of redundance antennas taking care of this. This would basically be handled through, you know, a handful of court cases that then would be cited by everybody else.
Yeah. PRB1 is an interesting question then, because I promised I wouldn't do this, and now I'm going to do it. does PRB1 give you any heartburn? It doesn't apply to private contracts, but it is the federal government putting its thumbprint on states and local governments.
Not one iota. It basically, it follows the rules. It follows the Constitution. It does give some people heartburn, I will admit, but it doesn't give me heartburn. Because, again, it's in the framework of, quote, the rules, unquote. Whereas what's being proposed right now is, again, basically getting Uncle Sam to make about 100,000 of us happy and hack off all of our neighbors.
Okay. So, folks can find you on QRZ.com. Your email address is there. If they're a member, I think you have to be a member to find email addresses on QRZ.com. So,
right. And very simply put, you know, my call sign, you know, November 8, Mike Sierra Alpha. You can just plug at ARRL.net, you know, behind that.
And there you go.
Reach me quite easily.
Yeah. Speaking of ARRL.net, ARRL is, of course, not only a strong supporter of this, they're the folks that got it initiated. Is this going to make you tear up your membership card and write angry letters to Newington?
No, because I'm not a single a single issue kind of person about anything about the ARRL. Yeah, I don't agree with the ARRL on a couple of topics. I don't agree with, and this is going to make even more people angry at me, but, you know, they've taken some, I think, hard to defend positions about amateur radio operation inside of moving vehicles. There's a couple of editorials that they've made and a couple of letters that they've written to various jurisdictions that I don't agree with either. But overall, I believe that they're good for the hobby. I believe that they're all we got, and I'm still going to keep my membership, still going to pay my dues, and I'm going to be happy with them overall, but I don't agree with them on this.
Yeah, I think we'd be hard put to find anybody who lines up with every position that ARL has. And I think that they take some of those positions against perhaps some of the leadership's better judgment, just because they realize they've got to keep the membership reasonably happy.
Well, the quintessential question of democracy and or republicanism, you know, do you do what you think is right, or do you do what your constituency wants you to do?
Yeah. And I think the answer to that is you do some of both. You
know, sort exactly. Of,
as you say, not a single issue person. You pick your battles.
Exactly.
So as I was checking to make sure that you weren't a whack job, I came across your blog. Let me put that on the screen here for a second, and discovered that you have some interests in some of the things that we've covered here on Ham Radio Now. Right here at the top, we're looking at what you're doing with a Flex 6700. You are a software-defined radio kind of guy, and it goes beyond the Flex stuff, it would appear.
Right. So, basically, in fact, many of us are SDR enthusiasts, whether we know it or not, because almost every radio that you can buy today is in some way an SDR, whether it has a knob on it or a pretty screen with a bunch of squiggly lines. But no, I very much enjoy experimental radio, and that's a common thread that you'll see through the blog and, you know, through my shack if you look through it, or if you speak to me directly. I enjoy experimental radio. I don't get to create everything that I would like to today, so, you know, get a little bit of time to make like my own interface circuits occasionally, and, you know, make my own power supplies occasionally, make my own antennas occasionally. But there is a very strong experimental radio movement, and the Open HPSDR organization has come together and designed some fantastic experimental radios, and that really is why I created that blog. Phil Harmon, whom you had, I believe, a four video series from the 2009 Tapper, 2008 or 2009. You probably
I think it was 2008, because it was the first one I was at, and he described the process that he went through in designing. I think he did the software on what he called the Mercury receiver.
Did some of the hardware design. He did the firmware as well. I mean, he also developed some software, but he's primarily responsible for the field programmable gate array, the FPGA firmware.
Yep.
And the point I'm making is that has turned into a widely adopted project. Commercial manufacturer of electronics in India approached Tapper and has been offering radios based on these designs for a year. And that's kind of why I started the blog, was to kind of help get the word out and kind of explain what I thought they would do and wouldn't do, and then what I actually found that they would do and wouldn't do. And, you know, basically give these things a chance.
Yep. That's the Anon radio from Apache Labs that I'm looking at on your blog right now.
Correct.
Which you're selling, by the way. Have you sold it yet?
No, that's still available. So if anybody can wade through the hate mail, I actually have two of these, and I constantly buy and sell radios. If you know me, I'm always trying new things. And one of the things that I do, and in fact, my most recent article kind of relates to one of the things that I do. I like to set up receivers that will take in great gulps of bandwidth and decode signals out of it, and then take these decoded signals and upload them as spots to the internet. And to that end, the boards that actually go inside of that gray box inside of the Apache Labs Anon 100D, the Angelia board, I'd like to buy a couple more of those. I don't really transmit with this particular radio very often, and besides, I have that and a plethora of other radios. So, yeah, there's nothing really than anybody should read into the fact that I'm selling, that I'm always selling a radio.
Okay, so they come and go. The thing about these is this is starting with the Mercury that that Phil Harmon designed in part. The idea is you come out of the antenna connector, you go through a filter. You need a filter at the front end somewhere. And then into a digital to or analog to digital converter. Digitize things right up front. And I am no engineer, but I've had this stuff pounded into my head long enough. I'm starting to understand and appreciate at least a good deal of it. And now that you're in the digital domain, you can do wonderful things. The HPSDR systems still shovel all of that data out of their system for the most part and into your computer to let your computer do most of the heavy lifting, processing those signals, doing the filtering and the modes and things like that. The step that Flex has taken, because their radios did the same thing, the 3000 series, the 1500, did the same thing. It needed a fairly beefy computer, and they ran into trouble with people trying to run computers that weren't up to the job or for some reason were not quite compatible. So
they do to this day, indeed.
Yep. So the smart thing that they've done is pull the heavy lifting, the processing. They put big processors in the radio, and all your computer now is the interface, is the human interface for the most part. So that HPSDR has not done that yet that I know of. Have they gone? Are they trying to do that? Have they got any ideas about that being a direction to go? If they do, you'll hear about it in Austin in September.
I'm sure. Right. And the short answer is no, and I'm by no means a spokesperson for the open HPSDR community, but there are a number of public forums. There's a open HPSDR TeamSpeak. There's a mailing list. And the overall impression that I get from the developers is that we're going to stay with a limited amount of functionality inside of the radio. And without, doing a deep technical dive, they have recently moved some of the CW logic inside of the radio to reduce latency. But the design focus, the design principle of this is that the radio is basically an analog to digital converter, and the FPGA is a kind of a first order filter to kind of knock down the bandwidth a little bit. And then the PC software does most of the, does virtually all of the DSP. The Flex, on the other hand, and it's not necessarily readily apparent unless you really dig into it and talk to them. There are some similarities in the architecture, but one of the key differences between the Flex and the Open HPSDR is that after they digitize the incoming RF, and after they divide it down, after they knock down the quantity of data a little bit, it goes to a DSP that's, in fact, very similar to the DSPs in Yaesu's, Icon's, Kenwood, so on and so forth. So it uses basically the same Texas Instruments family of components to do the modulation and demodulation that an FTDX 5000 from Yaesu would, for example. So it's significantly different architecture, and they behave somewhat differently.
Are there advantages to keeping things in your computer and not pulling everything into the radio?
Yeah, and I think I can summarize this very quickly, and I'm vastly oversimplifying. But
we need to do that. This isn't going to be a DCC talk here. We're talking to folks who are just learning this stuff.
Right. I'm not capable of doing it, but I do get asked this quite frequently. And the short version is that you have one architecture, do it all in the PC, the other architecture, do it all in the radio. The do it all in the PC architecture gives you great flexibility and great performance. I think that with respect to pulling audio. In other words, pulling baseband, pulling what you can actually hear out of a sideband or a CW signal or something like that, I think the open HPSDR is the best. And I've actually run some tests to confirm this gut instinct, and they'll do amazing things with very, very little in the way of the signal. On the other hand, the downside of this strategy is that you need to have a very good network connection between the radio and the PC. The PC's Ethernet connection and audio equipment needs to be top-notch, and you need a relatively strong laptop or desktop to do the DSP effectively. If you don't have all of these in place, and it can be a little fiddly to have all of these in place, and this is where we get into the experimental part of experimental radio, then it sounds bad and it transmits worse. So upside works very, very well. Downside's a little bit fiddly. On the other side, the flex strategy is that basically, and this is not something necessarily that's readily apparent, but the flex 6700 and 6500, and I'm not sure to what extent the 6300 is, but the 65 and the 6700 are essentially Linux PCs with radios built in them, or radios inside of Linux PC. Everything is very closely coupled, and the DSP is done on a Texas Instruments DSP chip. So what this all basically means is that it's all commercialized. It's all made to work pretty seamlessly. The connection to the PC can be very modest. The performance of the PC can be very modest. In fact, I know that you've had a couple of conversations with Greg Jurens. You know, he's basically said that, and it really turns out to be true that the PC performance becomes almost irrelevant. So all the components talk to each other in near real time inside of a black box. The downside of this is that that architecture isn't mature yet, in my opinion. The architecture is different from anything that they've done before, specifically because they're using a DSP chip, and they're not doing this complete. They're not doing the modulation and demodulation completely in software the way that they used to. So now they're having to develop DSP algorithms for the DSP chip, and they're kind of on the left-hand side of the learning curve on this. So the noise blanker and the noise reduction doesn't work quite as good, frankly, as the open HPSDR stuff. So right
does
now,
does it work better than the 5000 series and 3000 series?
I think in many regards it does. I still think it's can't hear quite as well as the earlier 3000, 15000. The DSP in PowerSDR, which is where the heavy lifting is done, is just a little bit more mature and should be, you know, because they worked on it, you know, for a long, long time. PowerSDR DSP is a little more mature than the DSP that they have inside of the radio. It's coming along very quickly. I know that they've invested a lot in the way of human resources and in software development tools to mature that as quickly as possible. And I have seen a significant increase in capability and performance since I originally purchased mine, but it's not quite there yet. It just doesn't quite hear as well as, say, an ICOM 7700 or an open HPSDR radio.
Yeah. You've had yours for about 6 months?
Roughly, maybe a little bit less, but somewhere in that territory. And I've had that non-100D in that picture. I think that's one of the first in the United States. I've had that since April, and I bought a second one used several months after that. April of 2013.
So the good news about the Flex system is that it's upgradable. And the issues that you're seeing now, which they may or may not dispute, I don't know. But assuming that they are, as you say they are, they are working on it and they'll be fixed.
Yes,
I would guess you wouldn't have asked them to wait and not put the radio out until they get all that totally buttoned down. You'd rather have it now.
Well, and this is one of the things, you know, I've tried to discuss a number of topics in my blog, and that's one of the things that I touch on in the blog is performance versus stability. And come to find out, many of the people that buy these are very feature hungry. You know, everybody has a particular, you know, especially when you're talking about an SDR, what, you know, the classic vision of an SDR is this knobless box, you know, with a bunch of squiggly lines on a monitor with a, you know, pan adapter and a waterfall on a PC monitor. And yeah, Flex definitely is that. And people that buy Flexes tend to be a little bit more experimental, maybe, than people that generally buy knob radios. And so they have often niches that they want to see addressed. Sometimes they're not niches. There's a handful of capabilities that didn't ship out with the radio and aren't on the radio yet. For example, FM. FM is simply not in the signature series yet. It's something that they're working on. But my whole point is that there's a voracious appetite for features and capabilities, and maybe a little less so towards, you know, working out bugs, you know, working on stability, you know, things of that nature.
Yeah, I imagine that the blogs and email and every other correspondence to Greg and all the rest of the folks there is a long, long list of things that they would like to see added,
right,
as well as improved or fixed or whatever. They know that it's like any software. Software's got bugs. This is a lot of software.
Well, exactly. And, you know, this is not a motion control system on a car, you know, which is, you know, this kind of systems, you know, that I come from. You know,
yeah, that, by the way, that is your expertise. Is you've got some technical chops behind you, and that's where you work in cars because you're in Michigan.
Yeah, well, not everybody in Michigan. So, yeah, that's a logical fallacy. Not everybody that lives in Michigan works on cars. But, yeah, I come from the automotive industry. I come from powertrain and network development.
As it so happens, I was born in Detroit and grew up up to age 12 in Southfield, which is a little bit more toward the direction that you live in. And at that point, moved off to, with the family, age 12, moved off to Chicago. My dad worked in insurance, did not build cars, but GM was this big client. So,
I remember you mentioning that on earlier shows. And in fact, if I remember correctly, you found your first job in radio in Chicago, if I remember correctly.
Actually, the first job in radio was Sturgeon Bay, Wisconsin, WDOR, the voice of Cherryland.
For somebody like me that grew up in Michigan, anything would have been about a 200-mile radius of Chicago with Chicago, basically. Yeah. Sorry about that.
That's okay. And I spent, as I was living in Chicago, a friend of mine had a cottage on the eastern end of Lake Michigan, the western side of the Lower Peninsula. So I spent every summer, all summer, up there near Muskegon. Nice little ham radio store up there at the time. Probably not there anymore.
Yeah, I think that there is approximately 0.5 amateur radio stores in the entire state right now.
Yeah.
Sad. Yeah. Yeah. Such is the state of the industry.
Yeah. We had one in North Carolina and it went away too.
Right. Anybody that's really interested in finding out what works and what doesn't work on a signature series radio or on an open HPSDR radio, there are resources on the web. I have a number of links in my blog that will take you to these. There's both an open HPSDR and an Apache Labs Yahoo group, for each respectively. Flex Radio Systems has their own user community. It's actually a very well-coded website, a lot of functionality, a lot of good search tools and things like that. And when people make a comment, hey, I'd like this to do that, then it's there in the community, and actually you have an opportunity to vote on it. You know, hey, I would like to, I'd also like to see this, or no, I'm not concerned about this. Or if somebody posts an issue, when I push this button, the expected action doesn't occur, then the same thing. I'm experiencing this as well, or I'm not experiencing this. So it's a very rich user community. But Flex is pretty open about, you know, what works and what doesn't work on the radio right now, you know, what they're seeking to improve. They have a roadmap that they've published, which, you know, I think takes a, you know, a little bit of guts, you know, to say, okay, on this date, we're going to do that. And, you know, sometimes the dates slip and they get yelled at a little bit. But, you know, in my experience, they've done virtually everything that said they were going to.
The Flex system is not an experimenter system. It's for an advanced ham, but it's not something you experiment with. The HPSDR stuff, you definitely want to be a do-it-yourselfer.
I would tend to agree. I've got to be perfectly honest. There's a lot of people that have bought open HPSDR radios, and I don't necessarily think that you need to be a radio experimenter to get the most out of those, but you do need to be a PC experimenter. You really need to know whether you're using a Linux-based system or a Windows-based system. You really need to be able to debug especially network and audio issues and enhance the performance of these subsystems. If you can't, you're probably going to get frustrated. As for the Flex, I think that the average ham is going to have a relatively easy out-of-the-box experience. Having said that, there are some experimental capabilities. You know, they do have an API, an application programming interface, that they've been working on, that, you know, some people have access to, that are, you know, willing to, you know, sign a non-disclosure agreement with the company. There is a data exchange protocol, you know, that they've published, and almost anybody has access to. So there are hooks. There are hooks in the system for experimenters, but this is very much a radio that somebody can take out of the box, and they can pop up on their shack, and they can put power and antenna to, and hook up an Ethernet cable to their router or switch, and install the software, and have going literally in 10 minutes. And again, is going to be minimally influenced by the performance of the PC.
The APIs, I think, are for software developers to be able to add stuff to the capability for us not so quite so technical users. Do you know if those APIs get very deep into the radio, or do they just kind of dither around the periphery of you know, the software interface?
They get relatively deep into the radio. There's a couple of applications out there already that don't get into the very heart of the radio, but get moderately deep into the radio to do what they need to do. There are people out there making third-party utilities. DD Util, you know, is a good example of one that's it's not getting really deep into the radio, but it's basically, it's a third-party application, call it communications hub. So your logging software, your linear amplifier, your band switch, you know, things of that nature have a way of connecting to the radio via PC. So, for example, when I switch from 40 meters to 20 meters, for example, my amplifier will switch, my antenna will switch, my logging software will know what frequency I'm on, and so on and so forth. And this isn't a capability that was developed by Flex. This was developed by ham like you and me.
It sounds like, and correct me if I'm wrong, that these APIs won't be building new filters for you or adding that mode that you might like to have that's not already built in. Can they get that deep?
I believe that they can. I've never really had a conversation about that. I've played with and haven't really had the time to get very serious doing that with open HPSDR software. In my limited conversations on this topic with Flex, and this is something that you might want to ask Greg, I think that the short answer is yes, that somebody could reach the radio to that level, create a capability. Like, for example, Codec 2. Create a Codec 2 implementation for the radio, submit it to Flex. Flex would, take a look at it and potentially incorporate it, into the radio at some point. So I think that capability exists. I don't know of anybody doing that at this point, but I believe that the capability exists.
All right. We are running close to the end of the clock here, the amount of time people out there on the internet are willing to watch the program. But I do, since you brought up Codec 2, I do want to ask you if you have some interest in the digital voice modes, either on HF or VHF, UHF.
I absolutely do. I've used Codec 2. I've used
FreeDV.
FreeDV, thank you. On a number of occasions, I've had a couple of contacts. It's not something that I use routinely because I'm 95% a digital mode person, but I have demonstrated it at club meetings, field days, so on and so forth. I think it has
the digital mode person you are is the keyboard type as opposed to the voice type.
Yeah, in fact, it's more, weak signal modes. So JT65HF, JT9, for example. So
very slow typing keyboard.
Yeah, exactly. And in fact, not so much on the keyboard. Yeah, exactly. If you go to PSK Reporter or Reverse Beacon Network and you put in my call, you can see, what I'm listening to at any moment. You can see how my antennas are working. And that's the kind of stuff that's really fascinating to me. 99% receive, 1% transmit, 99% digital modes and CW skimmer. But the key point is that, I still use, not on HF, I don't use D-Star very much. It really can't deal with atmospheric fading, with selective fading. It's not a lot of fun. But Codec 2 works, pretty well on HF, and I have experimented with it, and I do encourage its use.
Yeah, looking forward to that. So I want to mention to the audience that this here that I've been talking about for a good long time, my review of the Yaesu, their digital voice mode for VHF and UHF, the C4FM, is coming up in the September QST. It is a huge article. I knew I gave them a long article to chew on. What you're looking at now is the PDF they sent me to look over and make sure that everything was correct, and it's page after page after page. I'm really looking forward to it being published. I had a few suggestions for things that they might make quick changes on, but nothing too significant. So now I realize why it took me so long to get that together. It is huge, and it's coming up in September. I have recorded and haven't finished editing a couple of videos to go with it. There will be a video in it for the digital QST folks that they produced up there. And they said video-wise, QST is full for September. So I'll make these as Ham Radio Now programs, and they will show operating the Handy Talkie, not the mobile, a couple of versions of operating the Handy Talkie, and some comparisons to some of the other digital modes, D-Star, DMR, and P25. We got a bunch of hams together with all those radios and went out and played, tried to find some weak signals and play with that. So I'll try to get those on about commensurate with the QST September issue coming out, which means it'll be about the middle of August. It means I've got a lot of work ahead for me. Mike, it sounds like that you're particularly interested in the stuff that appears at the Tapper DCC. Have you ever been to one? Or are you thinking about going to Austin this year?
I'd love to. I'm probably going to be in Germany at that time. So unfortunately, I only get to experience them through you, for the most part, or other artifacts that come out of that. Someday I'm going to, but usually, customers come first, and I can never quite carve out the time to do that.
Yeah, well, I've been making that excuse for some time here, but let's take a quick look at the Kickstarter, and we are at a little over $5,000 and 11 days to go as I produce this. And by the time you see it, the very first of you that will see it, there'll be 10 days to go and rapidly disappearing. And I will be spending most of the first few days of next week on email, on the phone, making contacts to round out the DCC. So I'll get this episode online. There are a lot of things that I would like to be doing in terms of making programs this week on the topic that we've been talking about, the legislation in Congress, and a bunch of other stuff. They just had a great celebration of ARRL up in Newington, and I would like to find out more about that. But I have that stuff that has to get done first as well, and some of this DCC video and Kickstarter stuff comes first. So that's what I'll be working on, and you'll be designing stuff to go in our next generation of cars.
Or these days, more like selling it, but I don't do a lot of active design work anymore.
Yeah, somebody's got to sell it.
Somebody has to do that, indeed.
So you are what my wife works, not in the sales arena. She works for a big technology company down here called NetApp. You're probably familiar with them. And she describes the folks that work in the sales department as coin-operated.
I've never heard that phrase before.
Feel free to adopt it.
Let me look it up first before I start promoting that through my organization. But
I don't think you're going to find any bad juju.
Okay, good. No, I mean, being like half engineer, half salesman, I still suffer from all of the sometimes not being able to decode a joke properly. things that engineers do. Sorry about that. So,
but yeah, you might want to check it out.
No, I definitely will.
So, Mike Alexander, N8MSA, appreciate both sides of our conversation this evening. I think it'll be popular out there on the web. And thank you for joining me at Ham Radio Now.
Popular or infamous, probably more the latter than the former,
The program, I think, will be well observed. And I'm hoping that we both get lots of feedback from it.
I'm just hoping that my house doesn't get burned down. But anyway, thanks for the invitation, Gary. Right. It was a pleasure.
Thank you, Mike. That will be it for this. Oops, I pushed the wrong button. I meant to put me on here. That'll be it for this episode of Ham Radio. Now, if you enjoyed the episode, got something out of it, thought it was worthwhile, and haven't done so yet, back there, Arvin has been watching the whole thing. Stop by hamradionow.tv. You can make a contribution. If you're interested in the DCC, still need to get a little bit more done on the Kickstarter. So two directions for you to go if you want to support the program, and thank you very much. For now, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, 73. Over.
And out.